cheer and jeer, celebrate or lament as their favorites win or lose. They narrate the event. They anticipate a turn or a finish. They evaluate the performance as a performance. So Mazur trawls the online fora, analyzing fan analysis. One interesting posting that she finds in relation to Shawn Michaels is he's a popular babyface. Shawn Michaels' collapse as a result of a head injury at Raw in 1996 reads, this is from a fan, I personally marked out huge. I was sweating bullets afterwards, and I was wondering where the hell I could find info on the collapse after. So the term marked out is interesting here. Mark refers to a duped spectator. So its fairly common usage by fans implies a reciprocal engagement with the illusion. Fans, of course, know wrestling as a con. Having enough self-awareness to identify when their investment in the storyline is so great that they mark out when they get too close to it. For Nicholas Rideout, it's in the collapse of theater as a machine for representation that theater reveals its politics. I want to argue similarly that in professional wrestling, it's those moments when work turns into shoot, like the example of Eddie Guerrero's bleeding head, that the collapse of spectacle reveals the politics of the practice. And those politics, I'm going to argue, are tied to work and labor. So Eddie Guerrero wrestling on through this curtain of blood covering his face is an extreme example of the show must go on, that old adage, which is usually tied to moments when the pleasure of performing is replaced by sheer dogged labor. So if wrestlers work, and as Mazur has found, fans, to an extent, work. What exactly is this work made of? What's its substance and its meaning? In this article, paper presentation, I consider work in wrestling both in theory and practice. I'll argue that professional wrestling presents an exterior of aggressive, brutal violence, jingoistic and often racist caricature, hyper-masculine stereotypes and often sexist and sometimes homophobic content, yet, all the same, its physical practice presents an opportunity for laboring bodies to model and practice the fundamental political principle of solidarity. And because fans also work, the event of professional wrestling opens up the possibility of the formation of what Leela Gandhi, who's Gandhi's great granddaughter, what Leela Gandhi calls an affective community, a community not based on shared identity but on the practice of friendship, a form of political bond that easily cuts across the field. Reading the affective community of the event of professional wrestling against the actual economy of the form, which is flagrantly capitalistic, shows that the form itself practices the old-fashioned virtue of worker solidarity. If Henry Jenkins has argued that wrestling represents certain melodramatic tropes for a working class audience, he says the experience of vulnerability is one, male trust and intimacy is another, and the myth of the national community is the third. I'd further add that the practice simply is these things. But most fundamentally, it's the practice of solidarity, the political principle that's increasingly disappearing with the rise of the new economy or the service economy in some theorists. So I'll give a description and analysis of wrestling as a practice based on observational and self-reflective data collected through training with several former and current pro wrestlers. So Jamie Lewis had the Gary Bevan on Great Courage. I'll explore the physical practice in the studio in terms of dance and physical theater with Tom. And then I'll contextualize the practice in relation to its emergence as sports entertainment form in the 20th century. Then in the second half of the article, I use David Harvey's analysis of variable capital and the body of the worker to develop a kind of political and economic understanding of what wrestling work is. Sounds complicated. So I argue that under conditions of extreme economic precarity, it's related to Foucault, what I would say is that these conditions necessitate disciplinary structures designed to produce docility to conditions of exploitation. And in this context, wrestling work as a practice in itself, it has real value that escapes this rationalist economics. So the background to this, in 3 days in August 2011, from 9 to 5, 3 days straight, it was quite an intense period in a small art gallery tucked under a railway arch in East London. I found myself learning to bump, take a fall, lock up, wrist lock, drop toe hold, flip bump, and headlock. An enormously diverse group of people, including including two drama students from the University of Kent, several artists specializing in blood work and cutting, former professional bodybuilder turned actor, ballerina, and the Irish artist Kira O'Reilly, seen here doing body slam. And she enjoyed learning the practice, but she later took up mixed martial arts for the experience of actual pain. And so writing in my journal on the first day home, I said, quote, "I'm definitely surprised at how much fake fighting actually hurts. I'm even more surprised that all this pain seems to be self-inflicted." End quote. The key question that anybody ever asks of wrestling is it real? And it seems irrelevant in light of the actual practice. So of course it's not real in the sense that the finish is the end of the match is predetermined. Yet, as Scott Beekman points out, throughout its history for spectators of wrestling, that's never been the issue. The outcome of matches, which before could be gambled on, those were less important than a good show. So in other words, the economic rationale for the earliest faked matches was spectator. So Roland Barthes might therefore have reversed his reading of wrestling as a spectacle of excess. What actually characterizes wrestling is excessive spectacle. So the wrestling trainer Johnny Rhodes in Sharon Mays' account traces professional wrestling to circus strongmen. So there'd always be a barker who would say, "Here's the strongest man, does anybody want to come and fight him?" And then spectacle. And similarly, Scott Beekman finds an excessive spectacle in the late 19th century athletic troops. And these troops would go around providing titillating entertainment for the ladies, and that's the word he uses, in attendance by having scantily clad muscular athletes pose as living statuary. So therefore, to ask after professional wrestling's reality in light of its history is strangely naive and doesn't make any sense, really, because one would hardly ask whether or not theater was real. On the first day of my training, and I'm just going to give a caveat before I go into this, that even though the training at the first session involved actually more women than men, and in the later sessions has had a significant proportion of women in the sessions that I've gone to, I'm going to use the masculine pronoun he throughout this paper because it references my own personal experience of it, but also has some connections as well to the gender dynamics that I'm talking about. So on the first day of training, Gary, the head trainer at the wrestling school, defines professional wrestlers as stuntmen for the theater. So the connection to stunts is apt. Wrestling is intensely physical, is often dangerous, and the transition from amateur to professional, which at that point the sport paradoxically loses legitimacy, the transition entails learning to perform the moves skillfully and safely. Over the months leading up to the article, as I continued training, I observed that wrestling shares a number of features in common with other quote-unquote somatic practices. There's a strong emphasis, for example, on kinesthetic or proprioceptive awareness, the perception of the body's positioning in relation to itself and other bodies. And so one particularly tedious evening left me aching the shoulders as Greg, who's another trainer, seems to take up the persona of a particularly brutal ballet teacher, saying again, again, again. So four trainees would take up positions in four corners of the ring. Without a counter signal, we would shoulder roll from one corner to the other in a clockwise direction, avoiding hitting or rolling into the other trainees. The goal of the exercise was to develop what he calls ring awareness. After all, in the heat of the match, Greg said, as we, fumble these rolls. He said, there's no time to think about where you need to roll. You got to get out of the way, he said, so that the other bloke's dropkick doesn't actually hit you. Both Greg and Gary constantly use the term biomechanics in their teaching, and the term usually evokes Meyerhold, but here it's used simply to mean that with practice, the body learns to work without the mind. In wrestling, it's the body itself that leads, responding instantly and almost unconsciously to the body of one's opponent's stroke partner. Nowhere is this more evident than the technique of chain wrestling, and I found this video from bhow.com of the demonstration of chain wrestling.
Hi, I'm Steve Nielsen, also known as Stevie Slick with UCW Zero Professional Wrestling. What I'm going to talk about next is freestyle wrestling. Freestyle wrestling is the amateur-type wrestling that is done in high schools and college. Some of the same moves are incorporated in professional wrestling. When we do them in professional wrestling, we term it chain wrestling, which is a close contact, exchanging holds and hold-to-holds and stuff. We're going to demonstrate a little bit of that and some of the way that we incorporate amateur wrestling moves into professional wrestling. We have Cassidy and Murdoch here who are going to do this demonstration. Okay, guys?
To know though that that's improvisation, that's not, there's no kind of sense that that's choreographed. The trainer in that video was saying that the moves were incorporated are taken from sort of high school wrestling and Olympic wrestling, Greco-Roman. The actual historical record shows that in a way that kind of wrestling that you would call legitimate is the aberration. So wrestling was came from sort of demonstration fights of Greco-Roman, but later Lancashire catches catch can, which was an Irish collar and elbow styles. Those were sort of exhibition sports, and in a way that to have wrestling at the Olympics is the it's the, that's a distortion, not professional wrestling. So the majority of the moves employed in chain wrestling are simply legitimate moves, and they added a number of extra codes that ensure that these can be performed safely. So for example, in that wrist lock that you saw, the bent elbow ensures that the wrist is bent at a painful angle, but yet prevents real injury. Similarly, the wrist lock can be transitioned into a hammer lock with the arm behind the back, in which, in this case, the onus is on the attacker to keep the partner safe, so the wrestler must keep a light grip on his partner's hand. So with the hand hidden behind the back and then keeping close bodily proximity, both performers are then able to sell the move, communicating the reality of the game to the audience. R. Tyson Smith connects this improvisational process to Harley Hochschild's concept of emotion work. Quote, when both performers are malleable, pliable, and relaxed, moving as a synchronized couple is easier. The adjustment to pro wrestling praxis demands emotion work because it's antithetical to the ordinarily hard body. In our later exploration of chain wrestling in the studio, as part of a larger dance and physical theater practice, my collaborator Tom Wells and I found that we began almost unconsciously to develop a number of bodily signals that would communicate the next move to each other, and often these signals were about how to perform the moves safely. So a clothesline to the chest, accompanied by a hand to the small on the back, would then signal the falling partner. Of course, the falling could then reverse the move before falling to the ground, throw the attacker submission point. In a power bomb, one wrestler kicks the other in the gut, making him double over. The attacker grasps his opponent's head between his legs, flips the other wrestler upside down, and then drops him on his back, but waiting until the hands can come down in order to bump safely. So the entire sequence of moves, when sold well, appears like a seamless act of individual aggression, but in reality, it's teamwork. Bodily communication can be semiotic, so a wrestler will slap his chest twice as if to signal aggression, but to his partner that just means let's lock up. A squeeze to the bicep during a lockup means you lead, but these communications can also be purely somatic. So as Smith puts it, quote, opponent's positions are anticipated without any audible information being shared. A forthcoming swing or kick is sensed by reading each other's cognitive, bodily, and expressive. Eventually, though, the technique disappears and the work becomes purely improvisational. And this improvisational work is highly valued among veterans of the business. So as Lawrence DeGaris points out, he's a former wrestler. Older wrestlers today despair of the amount of choreography that sometimes makes it into the wrestling for television. Sometimes it's even dress rehearsals. Through the somatic practice of chain wrestling, the practice of safety, trust, and an affective bond between performers becomes internalized and embodied rather than rationalized. Smith likens this synchronicity to two dancers well acquainted with each other, but unlike dancers, the practice of care for the other within this form of theatricalized or soul aggression gives this practice a particular ethical cast, which I want to name an ethics of rowdy play. The name harks back to the history of wrestling. So as Beekman points out, in the 19th and early 20th centuries, wrestling rowdiness that leads to its banning by many cities and councils. And the word play, which is usually set against the category of work, I'm going to connect to the Hungarian philosopher Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi's concept of flow. It's a very long name, I don't know how to say it. And flow is a state of deep mindfulness and focus that he observes in jazz musicians as well as childhood games. And flow is a state of single-mindedness, which is the ideal of creative and unalienated work, an experience of which is often blocked by the organizational principles of advanced capitalism. So here's a quote from Lars Stensen. When we are fully immersed in work, we lose our sense of having a distinct self and rather become one with the activity itself. And he draws on the flow embedded in traditional craftsmanship. An analysis of the internalized physical storytelling of wrestlers helps engage and illustrate his claim to be a craft. So on the third day of wrestling, we watched Jamie and Phil, who are both, you know, former professional and current professional. They started wrestling impromptu, and as they pointed out, they had never, quote, unquote, touched each other before. But we, as spectators, were presented with this compelling and complex match in which Phil, the bad guy or the heel, was able to land a series of painful and underhanded submission holds to Jamie, who was a good guy or face, before Jamie whipped Phil into the corner, landing three quick chops to the chest to stun him, finishing off by running the ropes to deliver a knee to his face. So afterwards, discussing what they had just performed, Jamie stated that, quote, Phil didn't know that the knee thing was one of my moves, but he knew enough to respond to it and take it. So in a sense, Phil and Jamie had internalized already a physical dramaturgy. And it seems endlessly complex, this internalized dramaturgy, to those unfamiliar with the practice, leading to many to conclude that it's all choreographed. But it's simply part and parcel of the improvisational work. Wrestlers endlessly talk about logic, about storytelling, about the psychology. Daguerre describes logic with regard to a headlock. Quote, both wrestlers must internalize the logic of the headlock in order to be completely effective. Not only does a wrestler applying the hold need to make it look like pressure is being applied, the wrestler in the headlock must sell the pain in order to illustrate the effectiveness of the hold. End quote. And the trainers are always keen to emphasize that once a wrestler has worked enough, he'd be able to wrestle anywhere. Wrestling is a language, they say. A wrestler from Japan will be able to wrestle a guy from Mexico, even if they don't speak the same verbal language and never touched each other before. So having analyzed this physical practice of work, I want to now turn to the work in relation to wrestling's economy. So first, it's crucial, I think, to point out that what I've identified as an ethical practice emerges directly from a certain amount of capitalist exploitation. So Beekman writes, well, until World War I, individual wrestlers, particularly national or world champions, maintained a level of autonomy that gave them substantial power over both their careers and the sport. After the war, wrestling promoters began to exert their control over the business of wrestling. The most significant aspect of this control became the adoption of fake or worked matches at the expense of legitimate contests. The promoters recognized that predetermined finishes kept fans interested in their product and left wrestlers at their mercy. So it's a kind of classical dialect of the moment. Capitalist exploitation, in the sense of removing individual autonomy from the wrestler, produces the conditions for resistance, in a sense of creating a practice that cements collective agency. Yet, as terrifying, I think, as the thought of a trade union of incredibly muscular men who know how to inflict serious pain but choose not to, as terrifying as that is, today there's more violations of wrestlers' rights than ever. So what are these violations and what kind of disciplinary practices produce docile subjects in this economy? So as a performance form, wrestling's oversaturated with discourses of work, money, capitalist economics. Inside the industry, professionals aren't called wrestlers, they're called workers. Kayfabe, relates back to carnival swindles, taking money from spectators, and new trainees are constantly told to sell their moves. At least three trainers I worked with during this period of research explicitly stated that one's gimmick was important because, quote, that's what makes you money. And even the storylines themselves, particularly in performances of world wrestling entertainment, often feature a babyface hero overcoming exploitation by Vince McMahon, chairman of what is simply often referred to as the corporation. So what corporation is which? It's the mythic qualities of wrestling, as Barth says, elevates this individual physical structure into an allegory for the working man. So this is Christian saying, I'm going to file a multi-million-dollar lawsuit against this company.
Well, maybe we'll all get a big laugh out of this, huh? I'm going to sue the WWE. Do I have your attention now? Because you see, I have medical documents stating that Randy Orton is mentally unstable, that he has serious anger management issues. Quite simply, that means that if you force me to compete at SummerSlam in a no-holds-barred match, you're putting your world heavyweight champion in an unsafe work environment.
I think that's amazing. It's a storyline for a match. So, you know, about health and safety in wrestling, the lack of U.S. health care. And interestingly, Christian, the wrestler, is Canadian, so he has it's fine. So this kind of working class allegory is produced in often appalling working conditions. Jasmine Muhanovic points out that since 1985, well over 100 professional wrestlers have died before the age of 65. A statistic that takes into account suicide, heart failure, drug abuse, so narcotics, painkillers, anabolic steroids. And the practice of wrestling puts enormous physical strain on the wrestlers, and at an independent promotional level, wrestlers are forced to travel long distances to matches and are quite poorly remunerated. Smith notes, in America at least, quote, performers have no labor contract from the promoters. If there is compensation for performing, it depends on the given promoter and the size of the house attendance. Some promotions provide a small stipend for that night's performance, $25 to $75. It's very common to receive no pay at all. When the effects of such physical strain on the wrestler's body catch up with them, there's no safety. Despite all this, there's little opportunity for workers to improve their conditions of work. So as Mohamed writes, the WWE has gone to significant lengths to break up any kind of potential emergency union for professional wrestlers. Quote, when Jesse Ventura, former wrestler and governor of Minnesota, attempted to start such a union in the 80s, McMahon quickly put a stop to it. Legally, they can't form a union of their own as they're hired as independent contractors. Though, there have been calls by Darren Aronofsky among them, for wrestlers to join one of the two American actors' unions as their work combines both acting and stunt work, which wouldn't do much, but it would at least guarantee fair remuneration. So the place where the wrestler's insertion into what in Marxian theory is called the circulation of variable capital, where that insertion is most visible is the body. And it's the same body that's simultaneously a potential site of resistance. It's the body of the wrestler that's alienated, reproduced, and endlessly circulated in the political economy of pro wrestling. David Harvey writes, laborers are necessarily alienated because their creative capacities are appropriated as a commodity labor power by capitalists. But we can broaden the question, what effect does the circulation of variable capital, the extraction of labor power and service have on the bodies, persons, and subjectivities of those to whom it circulates. So for David Harvey, who's a radical geographer, it's uneven geographical development of an economic sort in the kind that's found in modern globalization, which is bred through the bodies of those bearers of labor power who must sell their labor in order to survive. So a laborer sells labor power, which is a commodity, to the capitalist to use in the labor process in return for a money wage, which permits the laborer to purchase commodities in order to live, in order to return to work. So, for example, that uneven geographical development leads to different body types in terms of sweatshops. For example, sweatshops for subject of workers incorporated there into a totalizing and violently repressive regime of bodily disciplines, end quote. But I think the analysis of working conditions for wrestlers is not really akin to this kind of Fordist alienation of the factory or sweatshop. But rather, it gestures to a more universal economics organization, which the French sociologists Luc Potanski and Yves Chiapello have called the new spirit of capitalism. So the key features of this new spirit are flexibility and individual fulfillment through work on a number of short-term projects, though the material reality of this new economy is one of precarity, precarious life and labor, with the rise of fixed or short-term contracts and enormous amounts of reskilling, learning new skills throughout an individual's working life. Botansky and Schiapello argue from Marx that capitalism is driven with contradictions that eventually produce antagonisms that will lead to the system being untenable. So in order for capitalism to reproduce itself, they argue, it must respond to its own internal critique. They argue that the protests and revolutionary energy unleashed by the events of May 1968 in France and elsewhere were one such form of critique, with students, workers, and artists demanding autonomy, spontaneity, and creativity. It's these demands, supposedly, that today's connectionist capitalism, the new spirit of capitalism, claims to have therefore satisfied. But the reality isn't greater autonomy, but what Durkheim calls anomy, a feeling of rootlessness and lack of social norms and stability, the quote, mark of the elimination of the purchase that people can have in a social environment, end quote. So ideologically, the new economy promises greater autonomy while simultaneously making unemployment an individual failure. So the wrestler as laborer exists in such a precarious situation, not knowing where his next booking is going to come from and so on. I was told by one wrestler that the best work that one could get at present in British wrestling was a stint at Botman's. Despite the fact that the two shows a day schedule was physically grueling, combined with putting up and taking down the ring and traveling to the next camp, it's at least a few weeks guaranteed income. Economic precarity requires those inserted into such a circulation of variable capital to adopt certain disciplinary practices. So wrestling while injured. The Michigan-based trainer Josh Abercrombie, in his interview with Ted Pluck, points out that he often wrestles injured simply to pay the bills despite a nagging broken fibula that's not healing properly. Pluck goes on to note that this is a common practice among wrestlers, at least in that state. Precarious work also leads to promoters adopting ever more brutal working conditions, with extreme wrestling becoming more common. So a death match can involve smashed glass, light tubes, barbed wire, ladders, and stables. Hypermuscular, often shaved and tanned, suggests a kind of plasticness that gestures at another type of disciplinary practice. So simply, the bodies of wrestlers are reproduced and sold by promoters in images, posters, video games, action figures, and so on. While wrestling itself is a physical practice, it doesn't lead to the kind of hypermasculine ideal represented in WWE, which is endlessly commented on by announcers at the matches. One posting on the online forum for the wrestling school in which I trained, one of the head trainers just reads, quote, everyone needs to work on their bodies a bit more now. Gym, gym, gym. Great skills and great look is the difference between bookings and sidelines. So it's echoed by trainer Josh Abercrombie. He says, the biggest key, honestly, to getting over in wrestling is your look and your marketability. It's all about money. John Cena might not be the best wrestler in the WWE, but he's definitely the most marketable. If you're 6'6" and completely jacked, they don't even care if you can wrestle. As independent contractors, wrestlers are forced to adopt extreme training and measures to ensure booking, so the toll on the bodies of wrestlers is extremely high. Yet, yet, as Michel Foucault writes, quote, power, after investing itself in the body, finds itself exposed to a counterattack in that same body. While economic precarity disciplines the body of the wrestler, that same body can be thought of as a site of resistance. Or more accurately, resistance may take place in the intersection between two bodies. As it's the wrestler's work that may be thought of as a practice of freedom, being able to work among wrestlers is regarded as the most important quality, far more so than the visual capital of the physical appearance. Recounting his last weekend of matches, Greg told the class, quote, Mike had to fight a guy who didn't know anything last week. Seriously, the only reason the promoter put the guy out there was because he was a bodybuilder, but he had no idea how to work, how to tell a story. So the quotation suggests that the actual labor of working together, as I described in the first section of the article, has a value separate to that of the money wage for which the laborer is remunerated. For Smith, this passion work has an interesting paradoxical structure. Quote, this is men working together to serve an audience with a performance of pain, suffering, and antagonism. For these performers, hostility is almost always displayed, although empathetic feelings of cooperation, trust, and protection are actually being felt. So Smith, I think, somewhat over-eggs his pudding. His conclusions are compromised by too small a data set. As Simon Garfield's interviews with retired British pro wrestlers shows, the circuit's not this kind of loving. It's competitive and full of petty grudges in any kind of workplace. But it's the underlying bond of trust in laying one's health and safety down to another, a bond I'll continue to call solidarity, that wrestlers must practice in the ring first and foremost. Solidarity, a cohesion or bond among subjects, is, of course, a cherished value for the left, and fundamental principle of trade unionism. The practice of solidarity through work and wrestling is therefore a kind of embodied political thought, transforming a political value into a daily practice of resistance. Crucially, I argue on an individual level, it can cut across difference by the fact that wrestlers identify as workers. In relation to the conditions of the new economy, where responsibility for survival in precarious conditions is conceived of as an individual rather than form bonds with others solely through the achievement of skill and work radically refers back to disappearing models of guilds and classwork. In all likelihood, bonding through work may also have positive psychological effects on its male participants. Quote, the front stage performance of violence provides a veil for the expression of empathy between two men who would, in all likelihood, not otherwise share it. Considering wrestling work in this way enables us to redefine relationships of intimacy and male friendships. So Todd Milaccio argues that men's friendships are traditionally viewed as less intimate for the fact that they don't express emotion verbally. But he also argues that that's perhaps due to the fact that intimacy is always conceived of in feminine terms, so the verbal expression of feelings. And so wrestling work, I'd argue, is the experience of flow as a form of intimacy that is affective. So it's a pre-verbal or pre-conscious feeling. And we might therefore conceive of working together within workers' male friendships as equally intimate as relationships between women, though the male subjects might not voice or signify these emotions themselves. So the word friend, I use it here in a specific political philosophical sense. Leela Gandhi borrows Derrida's use of friendship to incorporate, quote, all those invisible affective gestures that refuse alignment along the secure axes of affiliation to seek expression outside and not against possessive communities of belonging. So for Gandhi, it's a minor, she calls it minor narration affiliation between, say, Indian anti-colonials and white English Victorian vegetarians that have as much part to play in resistance to power than a kind of Manichaean struggle of agents against states. I'd argue that a politics of friendship, crucially, doesn't involve shared identity in opposition to other definitions of community. So the old adage, opposites attract, is quite fitting here. You don't have to identify with others for you to be their friend, but you must share a bond in some other fashion, a bond that perhaps can be defined as affective. So one of the primary objections to pro wrestling, its representations of sexism and homophobia, its racial and ethnic stereotyping, can I think be read along these lines? So for example, in the early 1940s, Antonio Rocca rose to stardom on the New York circuit. He was an Argentinian of Italian descent, But the Italian angle was stereotyped and played on more than any other in order to draw in an Italian immigrant community. So while this stereotyping is a piece of shameless exploitation designed solely to bring in money and audiences, all the same, a practice of embodied cooperation is taking place between Rocca and his American opponents and partners. A practice of friendship that might not have taken place if that friendship was solely based on shared identity. So while racism, sexism, homophobia, and wrestling doesn't go away when viewed in light of this, the representation of these factors must be read in relation to the embodied politics of the practice. So we might enlarge this politics of friendship to encompass a community of shared practice that is wrestling fans. While not directly inserted in terms of labor into the circulation of variable capital, fans nonetheless practice kayfabe, and their affective bonds through competence in reading work may potentially cut across differences. So you can take, for example, Sharon Mazur's description of a wrestling bus trip to the WWE in Jersey, in which the diverse community of fans included both a pair of women who look like retired school teachers, one black and one white, a middle-class black family with children, a white male homosexual couple, an elderly black man, a group of Asian yuppies, and a man who looked like a James Dean impersonator. So, of course, I think the practice of wrestling is a kind of shibboleth, though, in terms of there's an inside and outside, which often does divide along gender lines. In every sense, this is a kind of masculine community of practice. So it's first and foremost defined around competence, something that C.J. Pascoe, among others, has called the defining characteristic of masculinity above others. So for the purposes of this article, I can't really consider the issue of gender fully, but I think so to conclude, Jenkins argues that wrestling has a strong connection to the working class because, quote, in the realm of working class everyday experience, strength often gets subordinated into alienated labor. Powerful bodies become the means of their economic exploitation rather than the resource of, for bettering their lot. In WWF, WWE wrestling, physical strength reemerges as a tool for personal empowerment, a means of striking back against personal moral injustices. And he was talking about the representation, the storylines. But as the analysis of political economy of pro wrestling demonstrates, wrestlers as laborers are hardly unalienated. However, perhaps Jenkins was also suggesting something empowering about the physical practice itself. I've argued that wrestling, like the neoliberal economy in which it's situated, is riven with contradictions. What I focus on here is a dialectical relationship between the disciplined body of the labor in wrestling's economy and the practice of freedom between workers' bodies that is simply defined in wrestling terms as free. I've analyzed the physical practice through my own training and found the practice of care, safety, and flow. And against the working conditions of wrestlers, this physical practice might be defined as embodied politics, which opens up the potential for communities of friendship based on shared practices rather than shared identity. So it suggests an ethics rather. And I want to provide a personal example to conclude. So at the end of one session in October, there was a guest trainer, Charlie, who took me aside and said, "You need to work on yourself." I said, "Well, I agree, but I'm not that good at that bit." And he continued and he said, "Don't take this the wrong way, but you're like all other Chinese people, or Korean or Japanese or whatever you are. It's not a bad thing. But you people are so dignified, you don't show any effort. Like those Chinese Olympic weightlifters, blank faces, nothing. So you need to sell, because your technique is really good. You need to see it on your face all the way to the back of the stands." So in one sense, I think I should have been extremely offended by that lack of tact. But I was actually quite delighted, because underlying the statement was a relationship of respect, because he recognized me as a fellow worker. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Broderick Chow. Excellent and fascinating presentation. I think leaving room for a discussion. We can go for another half hour. Hope you can stay. And we open the floor to your comments or your questions.
Something struck me when you were talking about the relationship and how the individual damaging. Say the opposite situation. really in the sense of really boundaries, even when everything is looked at the constraint. And that in the decision ultimately in trust and in some respect we don't like that, not as extreme, but that sense of trusting in so much of it is your life, and it's certainly your health on the line, and all this, as you said, in this step, they would be an intimate relationship. But interestingly, one would not be intimidated or selected, but they actually put together in the by someone else, and they'd be put into a series of intimate relationships that by someone else's selection, and yet they're having to actually work with them as if they were working with a lover or someone they had.
Yeah, that's very, very interesting, because I think then we can draw sort of connections between, say, the masochism and then the types of work of, you know, like Atlantic sort of Arctic crab fishermen, where, you know, that working together in terms of not being pulled over into the sea is already this kind of sort of physical practice that strain and often you have to pull the other back. And I'm just thinking of a documentary that I saw about that, that there are connections then and therefore between sadomasochism and what, you know, generally is quite interesting. There's been some work done on sadomasochism in terms of sort of representational storyline structures. But yeah, possibly to. Oh, it's always the end of the match is predetermined.
So they will then
agree
that before?
The promoter will tell them. Is that because, Anais, you've done the match now?
The thing is, it could be like just telling you're going to win and you're completely improvised all the way through. Or you can almost decide every move that you have. There is a first part, but you're going to take over and then I'm going to. And it can be, yeah, like a sort of dance where every move is going to be decided. But it can be they work very well together in that, yeah, well, you need to win in the end. And you're just going to work with the other ones, work a little bit with them, get them hungry or get them nervous. And it will then flow quite naturally into the end. But often they just learn what they have to do. So that's a bit different from going through the trying to do it.
Yes.
I was fascinated by, as most people know, I'm sorry, I'm not football and really interested in the football events such an effect on the community and the way that that works. And the sort of understanding of sport and theatre is producing different types of effects on the community. And so I suppose I think wrestling fascinating says that it's somewhere in between, in that there's the vast difference between most sport and theatre is that you don't know the outcome. And so that is absolutely part of the kind of, all you know is how long it's going to take, actually. And then at a certain point, you're going to have something that's gone on in between. And watching that kind of flow out of football match where things have gone up and down and sort of falling back and what's going on. So I'm sort of interested in that particular community, given that idea that they narrate it, the thing that they narrate it. And it sort of comes back to Sarah Kane being also a huge football fan, so we've been so disappointed that in fact the discussion about theatre was never anywhere near as complex or as intellectual as the discussion you get in territory of football match, you know. And so there's something then about this kind of narrating community who are actually watching these moments and knowing they are constructed to some extent, not knowing, you know, exactly how much in any particular moment is constructed. I don't know where I'm going with this, but that it just seems such a fascinating time to look at, because it's liminal, I guess. There's something liminal about it, but I'm never quite sure how to produce it.
Yeah, I think one thing you go with that is that in both senses, there's a, it's all about competence, you know, like
mm-hmm.
football fans like to know a lot, to know a lot about the sport. But the difference, I think, with wrestling is that they're, so Sharon Mazur has talked about the fact that fans are always looking for the point where the person to shoot, and so like things are a little bit weird, and then they can read something and like, oh, that's it. So competence of another sort. But with football, because the outcome isn't predetermined, the reality becomes much greater, and that is a different sort of investment in that it can be very exclusionary in terms of the fact that the team becomes a sort of signifier for you, like a personal investment into identifying sort of community rather than practice itself. Because you wouldn't suddenly, you know, your competence about knowing about football wouldn't make you instantly support another team if they were better. You see what
mm-hmm.
I mean? Whereas I think that would happen with, it's just much more close to sort of acting and performance,
mm-hmm.
that you would just, oh, that new wrestler is really great. This is what I like about it. And it's, you know, there's not that kind of same sort of passionate investment in the skills.
Yeah, I guess that's what I was getting confused with, because I was thinking the term exclusionary was all about how you describe that.
Exclusionary in the sense of
it's more that you kind of choose one thing that you do better.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting that you talk about competence. It seems to be a very different, very masculine. It's a complex argument. But instead of I know this and you don't know this, so I'm excluding you. You know it sounds more as a weird. To me, it seems from the rest of the world, those who know the rules and know what that means, they feel they're part of the club. And it's something that can push it up.
It's not exclusive at all in the way that it's readable and it's sort of readable drama. Like if you read like Roland Barthes' description saying like, oh, we're making the hills so despicable, and everybody can understand that. And it's almost like I don't know, so like theater show that would bring through time in your times. Like there is a really big villain and everybody is going to get this anger on it. And it's really easy to read. And then afterwards, fans got another sort of joy that they're going to see the techniques and this amazing jump or chain or whatever. But everybody can enjoy the fact that there is a hill and there is a bridge. And you're going to have joy that the good one, the face, is going to come over and succeed at something. And this is just like so universal in a way.
So you're saying that the fans will accept you even if it's the first time you tell them?
Oh, the show will accept you.
The show will.
Yeah, you can look at it where, like, that's why like, lots of little kids really
yeah.
like it and get into it. Because it's readable, and I can, yeah, when you become a fan, you look at something else and you look at the technique. And something like you can go to a museum and like a painting, even if you don't know it.
I presume that's an interesting.
Yeah, with a so what's been quite interesting about that is that fans on the internet, according to Sharon Hazer again, have been so so vocal about criticism of the film. That actually gave me a lot of like, try to form their own type of pressure, even if they know that they're being ripped off by someone else. So yeah, it's an embedded.
Aware of that, you know, consciously aware that they are part of the world, and whether it's possible for them to actively be criticized by that, or are they just as much sort of, you know, being used by the system, explosive, as much as the rest of the
system? I think that, you know, in terms of conscious elucidation, I'd be really hesitant to say that.
No, it's because you drew attention to the.
Yeah. I mean, that represents a kind of certain working class narrative, but also you see him later on in that match, he's fighting Seamus, six Irishmen, and he starts losing and then he runs away with the title belt. So in a way, that kind of representation is that he, like, real men stay in fight, you know, like goes through bureaucracy and all that. So the working class narratives are very complicated in that sense. But the other thing is that I don't think that sometimes it's too much to say that, like, I hate papers that make this kind of utopian thing for, like, this practice. Yeah. I'd say that it is a kind of embodied politics, and it does produce different forms of subjectivity, even if it needs a big push to make it to totally political. Because of the fact that the fans are a good example, in that once there is a kind of community of work in terms of knowing kayfabe. They produce their own sort of narratives. There's a thing called machinima with wrestler video games. So you produce your own matches that go on YouTube and you record those. And you produce your own stories. And there's a sort of real strong sort of tradition of fan fiction and the discussions on online core. And all of that kind of it doesn't mean that it's going to have to bring down that, but it's produced these alternative forms of
economy. Just wondered, Broderick, if you look at kind of the history of wrestling in the UK context, where certainly, kind of, I'm old enough to remember when it was on Saturday afternoons on kind of mainstream TV, and how popular that was. And the audience of that, which in my understanding was predominantly female, and then what happened to that in the 70s as our culture became more involved, and it seemed to die. And then in the last 10 years or so, what was happening in America is it was kind of reinvention of wrestling and having the stadium.
I looked at it sort of briefly. I looked at interviews with wrestlers from the period that we're from now, and kind of speaking about what the condition of the I suppose the next thing to do is to sort of do a lot of research and look at what people are actually saying.
And is it mainly American phenomenon now? So when you talk to an English fan, are they talking about American stuff? Or they actually talk about wrestling in the UK?
I don't know if young fans would remember.
But I mean, today,
is
it big enough here?
It's pretty popular.
It's coming back, like, because I know people that are working in the WBA or in the speech every time, which is quite big here. There is plan to very quickly within the next few months for him to come back on TV. And I think everybody recognized that a few years ago it was so bad that he went out of TV. That wasn't such a loss because it was becoming bad. It was shown on TV and everybody was going for what's going in the US, but I think the European scene is getting stronger and now he's ready to come back on TV and be like, we are an alternative to what's going on in the States. So,
just in the
70s,
yeah, it wasn't a certain thing. If you watch football or cricket or tennis, there's only some wrestling, which is a whereas these car players are being their own caption, aren't they? They're not being their sports program.
Yeah, well, it's interesting in Canada, it was wrestling shown on TSN as a sports network. Then later it was shown on so it's gone through phases. It's discussed in sports magazines and websites still. So in terms of its legitimacy, they're never gonna. Everybody just knows, that it's not a big deal. But I'd say during its history, it was never the big idea. It was wrestling was always about the strength of one.
You talked about, I guess, on the one hand, the effective or the biomechanics, the mechanics part, which I thought was really fascinating. And then maybe the economic analysis, and I'm just wondering if I were to study this across sport, and I have not done this, if you think of, let's say, the kind of practice going on in Batman, boxing, Batman, in the current affair with racism in the British football, and how that gets constructed. You said there's an ethics of physical biomechanics which would be outside of these constructions of other narratives. Are you arguing that? There would be no racism when men are working? Or is there always an aspect of potential discriminatory possibilities, even in the intimacy of the men? Yeah?
Well, work can always turn into shoes, so it can always become real. But the practice itself demands that it does. That's my argument. So, in terms of this is a very narrow thing, but the sort of 1980s was really sort of jingoistic examples of xenophobic caricatures, so they represented the Ayatollah, But even those practices, it demanded that they couldn't be a kind of, you have to work in terms of, it's very much like showbiz, that you have to work with these people no matter what, and there's a kind of ethical stance to that that I think is probably not available when it demands that it be real all the time. Mm-hmm.
So the shoot is the problem area for the ethical.
It's a problem, yeah, but it requires there to be shoot for it to work. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, sorry, just I don't understand the current discussion really about this incident with Johannes and where the racist production is coming from, whether it's actually coming from the corporation and from the media, or whether it is something that the parents themselves are good for. I like this scene that you played where he says, I'm going to sue the corporation. Any other comments or observations?
Yeah, I mean, I've put on something else, but I think the racism thing, I do think that is an area where you can actually separate the race from the world. Can you, with high five, actually say that is, I think, brings up something really interesting there, and I think the parallel with what's happening in British football is
is very interesting because there's clearly been rules. Like you've got the thing where there's rules set up, but everybody understands the rules. But that doesn't mean that underneath that there isn't, you know, it's the same thing with the homophobia in the British football documentary a couple weeks ago. You know that is, you know, there hasn't been an art British footballer since just as fashion and felt club. So that's, you know, looking terribly positive. And so I think that is a question where, you know, does somebody say something to someone in that moment? You look at who John Terry works with all the time and think, would you really call somebody, you know, a black cunt, which is apparently what he said. And what does that mean? And you know, what does that mean in the context of working together and with that stuff?
Mm.
So I think it's very, very complex. But yeah, can it be, can
yeah.
sustain that argument that it is? But somehow that work surpasses those elements of culture.
Again, no kind of utopian arguments here, so I don't think that it can be fully separated. But I like the idea a lot more that in the practice of working, sharing engagement with tasks, that a kind of individuality and individual self disappears. Pursuing a sort of form of labor in today where it's all about what do I need to do, the idea that there is something to be said about just to head down and absorb yourself. And it's not really depressing at times, but I think that the kind of fact that when I think of my father working in as a decent kind of factory, where there was tons of racism around during that time in the 70s, but it kind of didn't matter when you had competence over your machines. Again, do we want to go towards that? But in some senses, I think that Fordism would have been a utopian moment, but it's sort of it's pretty, we're seeing a kind of horrible capitalism now. So, what we could isolate as a value from those models is maybe something that is a emancipatory politics to get. It doesn't necessarily mean that, again, these things don't disappear. But.
Yeah. I guess the thing I was going to say before that was about as well as the embodied practice, but all those signifying and then the practice in the costume. I love that too, with those in the changing room, they're both wearing big white things,
their crotches, and it's all about the crotches. Like, oh, where are we going to look? It's great. It's fascinating that you are referring to labor history because that doesn't often come up in some of the research I see. Which is that we have to have one younger and first student who refuses with the development of the Taylorism to the Fordism to the post-Fordist body, and what that might imply in terms of worker science. When you study the training that today's flexible worker has to undergo, it's fascinating for me, and how that relates to performance and
one point in the voice is you seem to be suggesting there is a contradiction that actually the wrestler himself may sit beyond their working colleagues and friends and as well, and they don't discriminate between their parties. Yet, in the show, if you like, the point is what those have said, I've certainly seen it myself, but often that becomes arrogant, the fact, particularly from the other than the wrestler. And yet, it's ironic that the wrestler who get on with that, and what they see as the audience. And I know that part of the book about bad guys, sometimes it is on and I don't think the audience will walk away thinking, oh, those guys are doing really well. And when they in conversation, they think, well, actually, we should pay the others because we've been shown that they're not good. We didn't want to share.
I don't know about that. I think that evidence points to.
They can see beyond the show.
Yeah, I think that evidence actually points to, well, maybe there are people. Who come away with it being passionately despising of certain races. But I also think that we see narratives like that on TV and in films and in theater. I don't know if we can terms of what we know about spectatorship and how you analyze it, that it's such a direct effect.
I think it was very nice to keep my skill in the board to be very piece classes at that problem we have in the tech class in particular. And the bigger some at the time. So that particular thing.
I don't know, yeah, it's a again another thing about it, because you know, children are an audience for the WWE, and not the audience.
I've seen wrestling spectators interact with my sister was a fanatic fan for many years, and what was interesting there I found in the way she looked at it and experienced it, there seemed to be really this kind of liminality in the spectatorship as well, where on the one hand she knew it was fair, but there was always some sort of a doubt, and I think that also the whole idea of that sometimes broadcast as sports and sometimes as theatre. There is this thing for a lot of people, even people that know that it's fake, there's still something that makes it more real. And probably, you know, the moments where you not like the kind of thing that suing the company as well, you know, is that real or is it not? So is there something to it? And I think for her, the whole experience really had to do something with that. There was some reality to it. So on the one hand, it was a very simple narrative there, and then the kind of the reality aspect of it for her made it a very nice place to approach it, because it was very easy not to do this or that. But then in that context, I think the old kind of ideology that's in there is very scary. I've never seen it from the wrestler side, but you know, it wasn't quite at all a very, you know, religious orientalist subject stuff, actually, you know, buy into that ideology as well. I don't know.
Yeah, I wonder if the reality, I'm just thinking there, I think it's a match I saw yesterday where it was like climbing a ladder and then like dropping from that ladder into somebody's arm into a flip. And I thought that's a stunt work, and it's the kind of reality that we enjoy watching when we see stunt. And I wonder if that's the kind of reality rather than context. So it's not kind of on it.
No, I mean, it's just, I only hear one case, of course, but I think the way she perceived these things is definitely different from us who watch a film or see a subject.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think there is something there which makes it very difficult to put your finger on. It probably also means that it's polysemic then. Because, you know, it's accessible for a lot of people. Like my sister is a girl who kind of draws from social interaction with other people, or maybe for, you know, the schoolboy who likes this sort of violence. It's, you know, could mean very different things.
Yeah, no, definitely.
We have time for one or two more, please, over here.
Yeah, a bit of a change of topic. We said something before about the wrestling being sort of like dancers in the ring. And from when I do it myself, there's definitely like a rhythm. It really feels like wrestling would be a chain wrestling. It feels like going into like contact and improvisation. But is there anything like written on that? Or do the wrestlers feel themselves in any way like that? Because it has such strong to me when I do it, it completely feels like I'm almost like a dad.
I don't know if there has been anything like that. We've certainly been saying it a lot in the classes, but that's because all these artists
people who know about contact improvisation.
So it's still like we've got this gymnast coming out training and he's kind of big jiu-jitsu. Everybody say that it's combining all those things. And I know some wrestlers who might be really good dancers, they want to give them this awareness and to the body. But,
I think what this means across all the people, so good.
Yeah.
I'd like to see wrestling.
It was actually amazing watching the video of the guys demonstrating the chain wrestling, because it's like watching almost like ballet, but then like everything ends up with a heart. The flow terminates, so it's like a constant flow and graph. That's what it looks like, at least to me. So I think there probably is something in terms of writing about movement, in terms of because contact improv constantly flows, but with wrestling, it's like the flow happens and then it stops.
But then you compare it to jazz, and I think it's really close to music as well, in the way that if you were exploring all the way through, people would get bored. And
yeah,
in a certain reason. That's why the storyline is so important. Mm-hmm. Like, it needs to flow at some point, but it seems suspense to get people attached to it. So it could, I think, yeah, people liking the music or they can get the psychology of this really easily.
Do you have the reference to the recovering an author who was much liked in the 80s?
She's
Gehan Hemilov. Do you have that somewhere here?
No, not on that.
The flow is kind of, I think it's interesting. And I don't know that we have another first person witness narratives from wrestlers with content improvising. It's absolutely lacking that we hear from people writing.
Similar to bodybuilding studies, for example. It's not just emerged. You're simply lucky that a couple of bodybuilders happen to be academics.
But this one, though, and I thought it was a nice touch that you showed us a slide of
body slamming and shoot on the
The
body art.
Yes.
Any last comment for Yoko?
I just wonder if, you know, the very origin of the wrestling, because I was in theater, I think, and it came from a ritual representation of the body. So, but in for wrestling, it's obviously fake and it's a sort of show, and it's I think it's created to show the fighting. So basically, from the beginning, it was a fight.
Pro wrestling. I think, well, that requires more study because I don't know about like an ancient Greece, and obviously, and also this tradition of wrestling in this country as well. So it may represent different things. But I think I connect pro wrestling back to early 20th century, late 19th century, early 20th century in America, where there was lots of immigrant groups who were coming in and doing fights for money to bring in kind of so it's like extra income and everything, but also it was about the spectacle. So for me, it's quite. That is fun to do, but they also realize that it was spectacular and that people would be okay to watch it.
Because you were talking about the fake and the genuine, and then and the theater and real and real. And then I thought if one wrestler really wants to see something real, and he wants to get out from the productions or something like that. But he can't really go away from the fakeness.
That is interesting. I don't know if there's any examples of pro wrestlers who become legitimate wrestlers, because it's happened the other way, where Olympic wrestlers become pro wrestlers.
I'm not sure.
Do they go into it? I don't know.
Yeah.
You referring to the divine origins? Were you also thinking of the Japanese context? I wonder what is the status of the sumo wrestlers in Japan in comparison to pro wrestling?
Again, I don't think we can say that. The only connection that I would want to make is that there's been a lot of match fixing in sumo wrestling and a huge amount of polymer in sumo wrestling. So connection that way.
Definitely for us, and I know to be really odd in their room, like even if it's like arts, like their technique is
hard,
like amazing, but even if we say we don't hurt each other, it's a really common moment. It's a question, and they think all this background of martial arts really fits into Palestinian. So, then, yeah, Mexican wrestling, American wrestling, English, Japanese are up there, so different. Should be probably so different.
Thank you, and I'm sorry again for really blanking out when I said Lucha. I was thinking of Lucha Continua, the Italian communist movement in the 70s. Lucha Britannia just didn't sound right. The Spanish for the same network.
Lucha means
Lucha. Well, thank you so much for your contribution today. And once again, on the 24th of February at 6:30, Broderick Chow and Tom Burns are performing work songs under the company name of the Dangerologists. And we put this show in the bibliography to our audience. Thanks also to our online audience for joining us today. And I'll see you all in a few weeks for our last segment.